So let's talk about Ozark.
Okay.
The thing, just in general, that show, I watched it the whole way. I'm glad I did, but I don't think even people that like Ozark, hardly anyone will defend it as anything other than entertaining trash. I mean, it's like, it's sort of like Breaking Bad, but it's just more outlandish even than Breaking Bad. It just got crazier and crazier as it went along, but it never really. It never got boring, and it was just fun to watch. And it would have a startling moment here and again, enough to keep you going. The way it ended, I don't know if it was satisfactory. It was kind of interesting, but it's a show that I think has done very. And we're just talking about Pose. It's ended now. Did very well commercially. I was surprised. Almost anybody other, you were the rare exception. Most people I talked to watched it and enjoyed it. And all the rest of it. Now, it's a show that it's the show I was referring to that I don't think ever really figured out if music was going to play a part or not. It went along for the first season or so, and I checked what song. There were songs in it, but I couldn't remember any of it. The people that made it seemed to have a fondness for Radiohead. Radiohead was used three or four times, different episodes. I don't know that I caught any of it. What else did I jot down? Oh, Plastic Bertrand at some point. I'm sure I noticed it when Plastic Bertrand was used, but I can't remember it. And the other thing, other than the song I'm going to talk about, the other thing I remember, there was this really funny stuff involving REO Speedwagon because they got REO Speedwagon played themselves, but it was, REO Speedwagon today, and they hired them to play their casino. And it was just, I wish I could remember specifics. It was just insane the way they were talking about them, like they were this really important band. And but not even in the Chuck Yeti, they were important in 1980 sense, but they were still important today. And oh, it was such a big deal that they were going to play the casino, and they were worried about getting extra security or something. It's just so funny. But the song that I just love, and I watched the scene again tonight, or at least half of it. Because it's used at the beginning of the episode and at the end of the episode, is Glen Campbell's Wichita Lineman, which I was thinking tonight. I'm always talking about the Junior Walker song, What Does It Take to Win Your Love? And I always use the word swoon when I talk about that song. Wichita Lineman is definitely one of the great kind of swoon songs. And that you hear it just the opening, and you are immediately
Oh yeah.
somewhere else, right?
There's a book about that song, by the way, but anyway.
Oh no, it wouldn't be in the Josh Clover series. There's a whole
No,
book on that
it's
song.
no, yeah. I've been meaning to look it up.
Wow.
I heard an interview about it, but I keep forgetting to look the book up. But no, it does, it's not part of that series, but
That's interesting. And which really plays into how it's used in the episode because it's the first, I think it's the first, and for all I know, maybe the only flashback in the entire three or four seasons. We've met, they're really important in the first season, this weird woman. She's in her 50s, or I think she's probably about 55 or something. And her husband, yep.
sorry, just back up a little bit because
Yeah.
all I'm seeing is you from the nose up.
Sorry, I leaned over, yeah.
I hate to interrupt you for stuff like that,
Nope,
but
you're right. So let me get their names here. Ozark, they are Darlene and nothing more exciting than a guy flipping through a book. Darlene Snell and Jacob, heroin kingpins. Jacob and Darlene Snell, and they're negotiating with Jason Bateman and his wife and Ruth, who's the other great character from the series. And I don't remember all the details, but the episode that Wichita Lineman is used in, it's called The Badger, and it opens the episode suddenly. There's these people you don't recognize them. It turns out to be Jacob and Darlene in 1969. We flash back to their meeting, where he's just come back from Vietnam, and he's there. He's chatting up some other girl, or actually the girl's more interested in him, and she just sits herself down at the table, and she's obviously had her eyes on him maybe even before he left for overseas, and she says something like, well, you can be with her winning woman across the table, or you can be with me. And one thing I can tell you is I'll never bore you. She's really brazen and upfront, and he's kind of taken aback. Anyway, she says her piece, and Wichita Lineman is playing kind of medium volume, and then she gets up and leaves, and then they cut to her and him later that night. They're doing some night swimming. And, you know, obviously he's made his choice. He's going to go with her. And the song continues, I think. It's very atmospheric. And then it turns up later in the episode where she ends up killing him. She has to make a choice, I think, between their heroin business and him. He's become a real problem. And she takes him out into the woods. And if I remember the scene correctly, at a certain point, he clues in. He knows what she's doing. And he kind of has a grudging admiration for what she's doing, her, you know, skills of self-preservation. And she kills him. And the song starts up. It probably, I couldn't check it online. Actually, I should have went back and watched the episode. It probably plays over the end credits.
Okay.
And excuse me. It's a real nice kind of wrapping up, beginning and end. But it just struck me. I can't, you know, if you wanted to take this series, it was entirely set in the present, and introduce your first flashback and just plunge the viewer into 1969, you know, you could not pick a better song. It might even be 68, Wichita Lineman. I'm not sure.
I think it is 68. And
yeah, you could not pick a better song.
Well, and that song must have a bit of a history in movies and stuff. You think I've seen it before.
I'm sure of it.
Yeah, the one I can think of, and I think you actually recommended this movie to me. You gave me the DVD. Is that documentary Tarnation? It showed
it's
up
in
that.
That eh?
Yeah,
okay.
It's the only scene I kind of remember from the movie, and I think it was pretty good. I'd like to see. It seemed maybe like a little bit overkill the way they used it. I can't remember. It was some kind of flashback scene where they were digging through someone's like recording. Like I remember it had something to do with a tape recorder playing or something like that. But anyway, I do remember very for sure it was in that film. But
that's interesting.
Like the sort of song that must have shown up in other movies too. But
yeah, no, Tarnation was a big deal at the time. Got a lot of attention. I literally remember nothing about the film other than it
yeah,
was
I can barely remember what it was about. Like
this weird guy, I think. That's all
something
I
to do with his family or yeah.
His family, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it was it probably came out after Chrome, and I think they were kind
it
of
was, yeah.
trying to get that feel. Yeah, I've probably seen Wichita Lineman used somewhere else, but and you know, if I have seen it used somewhere else. I'm guessing that what I probably remember is frustration that it wasn't used better. This uses it, even though they could have turned it up a bit, it uses it probably exactly the way I would want to hear it used.
Gets its due.
Yeah. And I'm thinking now if I heard Galveston in a film or Gentle on My Mind. Have you ever heard Gentle on My Mind? The other key Glen Campbell song from that era.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, I'm guessing, too, I hadn't thought about this, but probably when it was used, when did Glen Campbell die? It was probably not too long before.
A couple years, a few years ago. It was not that long ago, I don't think, yeah.
Yeah, this scene in Ozark goes back now probably 3 years. I think Glen Campbell has probably been dead for about more like 6 or 7. I don't know.
Oh, is it that long? Okay.
Yeah, yeah. And that was the highlight for the series for me musically. And you know, when I was checking the song list online tonight, it seems like I said they never really decided were they going to have a lot of music. By the fourth season, they weren't using much music at all. You know, so I guess they just decided they dabbled more than anything.
Okay. And by the way, you're basically right. Glen Campbell died in actually almost exactly 5 years ago, August 8th,
okay.
2017.
Yeah,
four days past the fifth anniversary.
Sorry, I'm just thinking all our calculations of time are off because of COVID, because the last 3 years looks like they don't even count. So,
well, and as I've told you before, I'm so bad with famous deaths. There are so many people I have to look up. Like, I can't remember if that person died or not. I don't know what it is. So,
yeah, Well, Glen Campbell, I know for a fact, just because he had a very
I remember him that he did
public
die.
case of Alzheimer's, right? He would
Right.
continue performing, and supposedly all he could remember were his, the lyrics to his songs.